Respected ulama, dear brothers and elders, mothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Normally you should commence with salam and then khutbah, as Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned, as-salam qabla al-kalam. But this is obviously just starting off on this point, and to further mention another hadith, Tha'lab ibn Hakam radiyallahu anhu, a great sahabi, he mentions a very beautiful hadith. All the ahadith are beautiful, but one particular hadith which captures our mind is the following, where he mentions, يقول الله عز وجل يوم القيامة للعلماء إذا قعد على كرسيه لفصل عباده. Allah تبارك وتعالى, on the day of Qiyamah, when he will question people about their actions, he will question the ulama. When he questions the people, he will also question the ulama as well, and he will say this following statement. He will say this following thing. He will make this remark, Allahu Akbar. This is a hadith Qudsi, narrated in the famous book of hadith known as Tabarani. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he mentions further that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will say, إِنِّي لَمْ أَجْعَلْ عِلْمِي وَحِلْمِي فِيكُمْ إِلَّا وَأَنَا أُرِيدُ أَنْ أَغْفِرَ لَكُمْ عَلَىٰ مَا كَانَ مِنْكُمْ وَلَا أُبَالِي. If you understand the Arabic, you'd appreciate more, but as a rough translation, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will say to those people who are learned on the day of Qiyamah, I gave you knowledge, forbearance. If it was not for me giving you this knowledge of deen, if it was not for this hilm and this forbearance which I had given you, it is for these very reasons, these qualities which I have bestowed you with, I have given you with, that on this day today, on the day of resurrection, I have forgiven you for all of your previous wrongdoings. إِنِّي لَمْ أَجْعَلْ عِلْمِي وَحِلْمِي فِيكُمْ إِلَّا وَأَنَا أُرِيدُ وَنْ أَغْفِرَ لَكُمْ عَلَى مَا كَانَ مِنْكُمْ وَلَا أُبَالِي. I wanted to forgive you, I wanted to have mercy on you, that's why I gave you my knowledge of deen. It's for this very reason I gave you this ilm, I gave you this knowledge, I gave you this faham and understanding of deen, I gave you forbearance, I gave you hilm. And for that very reason, and on that basis, I will forgive you, wala ubali. And you know what? No one can question me because I am Allah, I do as I please, I don't even care less. What a beautiful hadith. All the ahadith are beautiful, but this goes to point out the status of ilm and the learning which you and I have been afforded the privilege to learn. When I was here last, we spoke about after Ramadan, the need for reformation and so on, and I touched on just this subject about how to remain engaged with the Quran after Ramadan. And I thought to follow up with something, even though there are other things perhaps we could have discussed, but to follow a format, I suppose, I thought I would mention this particular hadith and mention something further. It's a shame, unfortunately, that if we assess our situation and look at ourselves, the sad reality is we are a contrast, or rather we are a complete opposite from that very same cry which Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'een once were. That same spirit which was echoed then is not echoed now. The same examples which were produced then are not produced now. We have to question, what is it which is causing the falling of this ummah day after day, week after week, month after month? What are those asbab, what are those reasons which are contributing to our downfall? We want to concentrate on this on just a little bit. But in addition to that, listen to this other hadith by Anas radiallahu anhu, who mentions, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, he mentions, سَمِعْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يَقُولُ, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say this, إِنَّ مِنْ أَشْرَاطِ السَّاعَةِ أَن يُرْفَعَ الْعِلْمِ وَيَكْثُرَ الْجَهْلِ وَيَكْثُرَ الزِّنَى وَيَكْثُرَ شُرْبُ الْخَمْرِ وَيَقِلَّ الرِّجَالِ وَيَكْثُرَ النِّسَاءِ حَتَّى يَكُونَ لِخَمْسِينَ إِمْرَأَةَ الْقَيِّمَ الْوَاحِدِ. This hadith is narrated by Imam Bukhari and Muslim in their respective sahihs. The hadith as follows, where Anas bin Malik radiallahu anhu, he says, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say these following words, from amongst the signs of Qiyamah, ashratu sa'ah, from amongst the signs of Qiyamah, do you know what they will be? As there are many which are enumerated, uncounted. Usayd bin Hudayr mentions a beautiful hadith counting the signs like Dajjal and Dabatul Ard and Isa alayhi salam coming again and so on. That's for a different occasion. But to look at those asbab which are causing our downfall. Number one, he mentions from amongst the signs of Qiyamah, one of those signs will be Allah Ta'ala will yurfa' al-ilm. Ilm will be lifted. Wa yakthur al-jahl, and ignorance will prevail. Ignorance will prevail. zina and fornication will be widespread, will be on the increase. In addition to that, drinking of alcohol, consuming of intoxicants will be on the increase. And furthermore, men, or rather women, will outnumber men in such a way where one man will be responsible for the kafalat and the looking after 50 women. This obviously has its own need of, you know, tashri and so on and so forth. But to focus on this point in particular, ilm will be lifted. Now the question which comes to your mind and my mind, which should come to our mind, how does it lift? How does ilm physically depart? The hadith of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is very clear. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَرْفَعُ الْعِلْمِ انْتِزَاعًا مِّنَ النَّاسِ وَلَكِنْ يَقْبِضُ الْعِلْمِ بِقَبْضِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. Allah doesn't physically lift up knowledge where people knew one night and then snatch the knowledge away. No, it doesn't work like this. Allah Ta'ala removes knowledge from people by giving death to eminent ulama. حَتَّى إِذَا لَمْ يُبْقِ عَالِمًا اتَّخَذَ النَّاسَ رَؤُوسًا جُهَالًا. And when the condition is such where Allah takes away learned people from amongst the people, then juhal and ignorant people then become the leaders of such individuals. These people will be so misguided themselves, they won't have no knowledge about deen themselves. فَسُئِلُوا فَأَفْطَوْا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is already predicting what will happen. These individuals will be such, they won't have no knowledge of deen. They will be questioned and they will just willy-nilly give answers to various fatawa and various questions in relation to the deen. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mentions, فَضَلُّوا وَأَضَلُّوا. They will be misguided and they will also misguide others as well. This will be the condition. When I was hearing a recent gargozari, as they say, about a narration about a brother who came back from a country far east. And he mentions that we visited the country, we traveled from east to west. He said, by Allah as my witness, I didn't see one alim in the masjid. There was no ulama in the whole masjid. Anyone would come, anyone would read salah and they would carry on about their normal business. This is something which you and I should feel very proud of. Alhamdulillah, that within the UK, Allah ka shukr, we have madaris, we have masajid, we have darul ulooms, and we have marakis. We have access to knowledge everywhere, subhanallah. If we still don't take advantage of this opportunity and educate ourselves, we are going to be those very sad statistics which Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned many, many years ago. The way for people to generate that belonging, that sense of pride, is to have that sense of belonging. You feel proud of who you are because of your heritage. If you trace back the efforts that were made for the people to acquire knowledge, where did you ever hear of examples about people walking from Medina to Samarkand, walking from, for example, Medina to Basra, walking from Medina to Damascus, for the acquisition of one hadith, two hadith, five hadith, to sit at the company of one scholar, to take from the knowledge which they have? These are things which are extremely important and we should take advantage of this within our very lives. And why am I talking about this with such importance? Is because unfortunately this is something which the Ummah by large is moving away from. We're moving away from. Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he also mentions a couple of other things as well. He mentions, there are a few other asbab and reasons for why ilm will become non-existent within a society. One other reason will be, is that people will not respect knowledge and will not have no qadr and value for the people of knowledge. What happens when a person is disrespected within society, people harbour hatred and envy and enmity towards that individual, that person will become reluctant to share what Allah Ta'ala has favoured that individual with. Right or wrong? When someone is, for example, now treated with a barrier of hostility, naturally the person is going to create distance between himself and themselves. Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiallahu anhu mentioned this is going to be one of the main reasons for the decline of knowledge which we see. And very sad reality is, very, very sad of a reality, we find our first primary choice when it comes to acquiring knowledge is not knowledge of deen, but it's knowledge of what we would refer to as worldly knowledge. Now from the outset, I want to point out, Islam does not discourage learning. Let me mention this from the very outset. Islam does not discourage learning at all. Islam encourages. And Allah Ta'ala even mentions, قُلْ هَلْ يَسْتَوِ الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. You cannot equate the learned and non-learned together. Learned people are far more greater in terms of their position, in terms of their status. And while we mention this very briefly, a hadith by Abu Darda radiallahu anhu, which is recorded in the book of Tirmidhi, beautiful hadith, he mentions, مَنْ سَلَكَ طَرِيقًا يَبْتَغِي فِيهِ عِلْمًا سَحَّلَ اللَّهُ لَهُ طَرِيقًا إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ. That person who treads on the path of knowledge, Allahu Akbar. That person who treads the path of knowledge. What happens? Allah Ta'ala will make way and pave the way for Jannah for that individual. That individual that goes to learn knowledge and learn deen and learn ilm, Allah Ta'ala will pave the way for Jannah for this individual. How much of a sharaf, Allahu Akbar. Furthermore, it doesn't come to an end. وَإِنَّ الْمَلَائِكَةَ لَتَضَعُ أَجْنِحَتَهَا لِطَالِبِ الْعِلْمِ رِضًا بِمَا يَصْنَعُ. And not only that, but the angels that have a sense of happiness for this individual learning and acquiring the knowledge of deen, spread their wings underneath this person's feet. And why? Because of the happiness of the pursuit of this individual. They are happy with what this person is acquiring. They are happy to see that this person is making the effort to acquire the deen. And if I just mention and sidetrack and mention one thing very, very quickly within, there is a hadith reported in Bayhaqi on the authority of Hassan radiallahu anhu, a mursal hadith, which as follows. He mentions, من جاءه الموت وهو, من جاءه الموت وهو يطلب العلم ليحيي به الإسلام. فَبَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ النَّبِيِّينَ دَرَجَةٌ وَاحِدَةٌ فِي الْجَنَّةِ. That individual who goes for the acquisition of learning of ilm and knowledge, and then happens to die en route, happens to die on his acquisition of knowledge. He happens to die on the way. Don't despair, don't be upset. Do you know why? Because first of all, The motive is لِيُحْيَ بِهِ الْإِسْلَامِ. So Islam can increase, Islam can benefit. He wants to be a reviver of the deen, assist the deen, Allahu Akbar. بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ النَّبِيِّينَ دَرَجَةٌ وَاحِدَةٌ فِي الْجَنَّةِ. Allahu Akbar. Between him and the Anbiya alayhim as-salam in Jannah will be only one stage. One stage between him and Anbiya alayhim as-salam. We have to understand, of course, that between one stage and another stage, there are many, many stages in between. Of course. However, this still points out rightly to the fact that how acquiring knowledge is something of importance with this ummah once prided itself on. Coming back to the hadith of Abu Darda radiallahu anhu, he mentions, وَإِنَّ الْعَالِمْ لَيَسْتَغَفِرَ لَهُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ حَتَّى الْحِيْتَانُ فِي الْمَاءِ. You know, a person who you can call a real scholar of deen, you know what his ajr and what his tawab and what his reward is? All creation in the skies and on the earth will make dua of istighfar for this individual. It doesn't even stop there. حَتَّى الْحِيْتَانِ فِي الْمَاءِ. You know, the fishes in the sea, they will also be obliged to make dua once for this individual at least. What an izaz, Allahu Akbar. And then Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mentions further. This is the same hadith by Abu Darda radiallahu anhu. He mentions that this particular scholar of deen, the scholar of knowledge, the scholar of Islam, he mentions that وَفَضْلُ الْعَالِمْ عَلَى الْعَابِدْ كَفَضْلِ الْقَمَرْ عَلَى سَائِرِ الْكَوَاكِبْ. Undoubtedly, there are numerous and multitudes of stars in the sky, millions and billions which you and I cannot count. But the reality is, the stars have their own beauty, they have their own brightness, but the moon is always better than the stars. The moon far outweighs and is better than those stars. It lets off radiance. This is the example of that person who is a real scholar of deen, a real person who acquires knowledge, a person who really has an attachment, subhanallah, to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It doesn't end there, it's further as well, but just to point out from this particular hadith, its importance. Unfortunately, you and I, we have to draw that kind of, we have to create harmony between the two. We have to create harmony between the two. Very sadly, there was an individual, one brother, he said to me that his cousin, alhamdulillah, he acquired a PhD in a particular subject. Very complicated, complex subject. And then, subhanAllah, he himself mentioned that despite all his academic pursuits, the sad reality is he still hasn't even read Quran once. And then it makes you think. We take a lot of pride in this. We take a lot of pride. But if I can say, my son, you mara putra the doctor, my son become a doctor, alhamdulillah, it's a good thing. And let me just mention further as well, in the time of Baghdad, 1258, if you look around about the time of the Mamluk era and so on and so forth, there were 1,000 registered doctors in Iraq and Baghdad alone. Islam promotes this. Islam encourages this. Islam encourages that we increase in our knowledge, both in deen as well as dunya. And to support this, I will also mention something further. If you take the example of ulama of the past, the example of Ibn Khaldun, rahmatullahi alayh, Ibn al-Haytham, Allama Khawarizmi, and so on and so forth. Take the example of Ibn Khaldun. Those people who have an inclination towards sociology will see he is the founding father of this particular knowledge. Ibn Khaldun, when you translate his name into English, he looks like someone who's Greek. We've forgotten our own heritage. We've forgotten our own heritage. We've forgotten who we are, where we came from. Ulama and people of Allah made them excel in both ways. Give you a few examples. Optics, in terms of the eyes, the tahqiq of the eye, the knowledge of the eye, optics. Ibn al-Haytham was that individual who excelled within the field. The world was chasing, playing catch up with him. His books were heavily relied on until the 1920s. After that many years of publication, that many years of reprint, still the people were in need of such knowledge like his. It doesn't end there. Whoever knows algebra, we all know algebra, we've studied it at school. Where were the founding roots of this knowledge? Khawarizmi, a scholar again of Islam. Other many, many examples we can give. Medicine, Ibn Sina rahmatullahi alayh, Ibn Sina. But when you look up his name on the internet or anywhere else or in a book, I don't say you should look, this is the general trend unfortunately. We just Google here and see what comes. This is not very good as well. But if you see the guy's name, it's written Averroes. Who's Averroes? It sounds Greek. It's not Greek. Ibn Sina was his name. A Muslim person. They've even minted coins in regards to these people. And it's funny how when they depict them, do you know how they depict them? Imama, beard, thawb. And you think, subhanAllah, a statue of Ibn Khaldun was made. Yes, we can go into the debating, yes, no, it's nothing to do with us. But someone, they fit the description, and subhanAllah, when you look at him, you'd think he's one alama. MashaAllah, big imama, and he said, long beard, mashaAllah, flowing thawb. And you think, Allahu Akbar. These were people who acquired the dunya as well as deen. But where we go wrong, and forgive me to say this, where we go wrong, we make the acquisition just worldly knowledge and nothing else. We are unfortunately lacking because of this in our terms of our deeni knowledge and deeni side of things. Islam does not say don't progress. Islam doesn't say that don't progress. Progress. But if that person who learns that knowledge does not have the fear of Allah in his heart, he will be a daku and he'll be a criminal even with his knowledge. Even if you take your car to a mechanic, Allahu Akbar, you can take your car to a mechanic. If that mechanic, with knowing his trade, does not fear Allah, it's funny how a 60-pound job will become a 150-pound job. Right or wrong? The essence of fear of Allah is key in any field of knowledge. Even a doctor will play around with your health if he does not fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He will say, I think the diagnosis to this illness is X, Y, and Z. Allah forbid, some even work alongside pharmacies. I will send you guys with the way you have to then give me a cut in the medicine. 10%, 15%. What questions? Why? When you should be looking, or person should be looking rationally with the brain, that Allah Ta'ala will also question me about this on the day of Qiyamah as well. Only acquiring just one-sided knowledge can lead to harms. We need to make islah of our thinking. And that's why I've chosen this particular topic, to talk about its importance and to make islah of our thinking. I'll give you a very extreme example which we have. We think that if a person acquires the knowledge of deen, we think that is the be-all for that individual. If he goes into anywhere else now, bas, he's no longer qabil and no longer mu'tabar, and he doesn't have the ability to even talk about the affairs of deen. A personal example, my own personal example. When I graduated, and it was just my desire, I wanted to study further, so I studied something in university. Wallahi, Allah is my witness, this comment was put forth to me. Someone said to me, you know what, bruv, you know the reality is, if you're going to do this now, you might as well shave off your beard and work in Asda, because you're going to go and work there anyway. And I thought, how negative and stupid of a comment that was. You're jumping to a negativity, why? He goes, because you studied deen, you shouldn't be studying anything else. That's incorrect thinking. So what, ulama are just a different group in society? Yes, we give them the respect, we give them the honor, because Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions as well, فَضْلُ الْعَالِمْ عَلَى الْعَابِدِ كَفَضْلِ الْقَمَرْ عَلَى سَائِرِ الْكَوَاكِبِ. The moon over the stars, we understand this. But does this mean that we have to completely shun that it's another life for them and another life for everybody else in the outside world? I'll give you another personal example which I came across. Obviously, mashallah, you know, to look after our health is something of importance. So I went and I joined a local place to do some exercise and so on. And subhanallah, one brother walked in and he see me. And first of all, he was shocked. And this is no exaggeration. He saw me and he goes, Astaghfirullah. Mawlana Sahib, you here? You? I'll be hungry. And I was like, brother, I just did a bit of exercise. From that day forth, funny enough, he didn't refer to me as Maulana Sahab. My name is Abdul Majid. Refer to me as that. I'm more than happy. That's my name. After that, he referred to me as Majid Bhai. Bas. Ye alim ke laik hi nahi hai, chodo. The mentality, again, this is where we need to make the islah of our thinking. That now, because of this person's pursuit, there you go, now we can't even refer to him as a person of knowledge. I refer to myself as a student. It's his khush fahmi that he referred to me as a scholar. Allah give him jazai khair. But the point is this basis here. Where are we going wrong? Number one, we've forgotten our heritage. We don't realize where we've come from. Look at the people of the past. Where did you ever hear an example of youngsters the age of 3, 4, memorizing the whole of Quran by heart? Challenge as an example, anyone in the globe, bring a youngster the age of 4 that knows the whole Quran by a book the size of Quran. But yet we have these examples within Islam, alhamdulillah. Look at the scholars like Ali ibn Madini, rahmatullahi alayh. 4 years old, Hafiz of Quran. 4 years old. By the time he was 7, he mentioned, I had already written a numerous amount of ahadith with my own hands. This is what you call achievement. And furthermore, another problem which can be raised because, or rather we have had this reluctancy to learning, is because of the issue of money. The issue of wealth. You and I have seen, perhaps, that in a particular line of field or knowledge, there's more money. Naturally, therefore, we always encourage one of three professions if you come from an Asian background. Number one, engineer. Number two, a lawyer. And number three, a doctor. And I can see some brothers smiling because they say, Jivaki, this is the truth.
Accountant as well.
Accountant as well. This is a new one as well. Four. People encourage this. And I don't say, listen, very carefully, I'm not here to negate anything. We need to become people of substance, of people of achievement, of people that achieve in dunya as well as deen. But does that mean that we completely sacrifice our deen, become content just on our worldly acquisition? That's where we're going wrong. We need to hold the two in harmony, hand in hand. And we need to make an attempt to acquire, to make effort. Anything someone gives us, we just say, okay, gee, this must be right. Have we ever had that just to do that thinking, that thought process? That let me see, is there any, what is this about? Make further talk to ulama, ask them to give, take some time off them and so on and so forth. But as I mentioned this point here, because of the worldly income which certain jobs bring in, we give preference naturally to those. We say, no, if my son's going to become anything, Avalan has to become a doctor. And then has to become this. And this is why I encourage, what time do we have until? Sorry, my phone. Okay, I'll just finish off on a card. There are a few more things I want to mention, but just a few more points and then we'll wrap up. One particular problem is we have is because we are only encouraging these particular things, our youngsters then, because of the ita'at and the obeying of the parents, they will just accept and do it. However, if your job is your job, you will never really like what you do. A person famously said in the past, he said, if you love what you do, then you never have to work a day in your life. Do you understand that? If you love what you do, then you never have to work a day in your life because you love what you do. For you, it's all fun and game. You actually enjoy being there. You actually enjoy doing what you do. But when it's strictly just a job, you're just looking by jaan churu, get in and get out quick as you can, get out of the place. There's nothing really to push you. Our youngsters, therefore, should be encouraged to do things which they, if it is within the boundary of Islam, encourage these things. A youngster came up to me and says, I really want to study. I want to become a PE teacher. I want to do something sports. And bichara, he went home and said to his parents that this is my desire. I really want to do this. The mum bichara went mad. She said to him, and then you have no respect. And I thought, ya Allah, he's going to express his desire. He got shouted at. And she said, no, you have to become this. You have to go and study engineer at college. We had this hope and this tamanna that you would, and this wish that you would acquire this. So he came to me and said, Maulana, he's only young, maybe about 19. He wants to study at university level. So he said, well, what do I do? So I said, simple. You just say that I want to study a sports degree, I will then become a sports doctor. Simple. Physiotherapist is still a sports doctor. Once they mention the word doctor, they're, ha ha, if you want to do this, But the moment sports was mentioned, we're thinking, Jeebus, he's just going to be running around on a football pitch or doing something else. Naturally, this needs Islah, and that's why it doesn't get solved quickly within one short bayan. But if we were to let our youngsters pursue those things which are permissible, they would love to do what they do and excel within fields. If you take a look at certain cultures, and specifically, I would say looking at, if you look at the statistics of more so Jewish people, this is something which I would say is a khubi. And our thing, al-hikmah balatul mu'min, our wisdom, them is, it belongs to us as well. When it's lost, we find it also belongs to us. How many people, and this is no source of pride for us, but how many Muslims out of 2 billion or 1.5 billion according to the statistic have been recipients of Nobel Prizes? Less. But then if you look at it from the other side of the ocean, many people. Now, as I mentioned, our criteria for success is what Allah Ta'ala, if Allah likes, alhamdulillah, this is our success. But you and I pride ourselves on this thing here. So why is it we're not achieving? Why is it we're still not succeeding? Why is it that we're still not getting further? Because we have turned our nazar from the deen of Allah. If we were to go hand in hand, Allah Ta'ala would push us further himself. So this is why it's extremely important. I have to finish at this particular, much more can be said, and I want to say, but just to leave on this point, we need to make an acquisition of our worldly knowledge just as the amount of effort we put into our deen, in our worldly knowledge and our deen knowledge. We take so much pride to say, I studied 4 years for a bachelor's. Did you even study Surah Fatiha with tafsir? Do you even know one juz of Quran with tarjuman? Not tashri', not commentary, just translation. How much knowledge do you have in terms of the deen? And Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mentions, Ya Aba Dharr, La an taghduwa wa ta'allama ayatan min kitabillah khayrun lak min an tusalliya mi'ata rak'ah. Oh Abu Dharr, listen carefully. If you were to learn one ayat of Quran from the Book of Allah, this is better for you than praying 100 rak'ats of Nafil Salah. So my dear brothers, a lot needs to be said, but we finish on this particular point. This is something within a community we need to really excel and move in. May Allah Ta'ala first give me the tawfiq and all the brothers the tawfiq, inshallah. The essence is this. We need to make an ardent effort to learn the knowledge of deen as well. Start off with ta'aleem in your homes. Your children will feel proud of their heritage, and it will also shut doors of many fitnas, inshallah. May Allah Ta'ala give me the tawfiq and you the tawfiq. May Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala take us from this darkness and this plight into the time of glory again, inshallah. It can only be done with the efforts of you and I. If we are just sitting well-wishing, it can never happen. We have to become people of substance. Forget having a wishbone. We need to develop backbones. We need to get on it, inshallah. May Allah give us all the tawfiq. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.